In 2020, you probably heard the word unprecedented more times than ever before. The last virus to cause global chaos before 2020, both in terms of public health and the economy, was the Spanish flu in 1918. Fast forward to 100 years later, and living in the age of modern medicine, access to good hygiene for most people, and advanced tech, the idea of a virus wreaking that much havoc again seemed almost unthinkable. Then the coronavirus came along, and here we are, in the middle of a global pandemic. The topic viruses has become more interesting to us. Probably heard people ask, where did the coronavirus come from? How and who discovered it? In this video, we won't talk about
coronavirus!
Instead, we will go back in time and figure out how we discovered the first virus. We will explore what made scientists stumble upon these little things that we love to hate. Let's set the scene. It's 1879 in Holland, and scientist Adolph Mayer is studying tobacco diseases. Tobacco had long been a significant product in the Netherlands. Ever since overseas colonial trade led to tobacco processing becoming an important industry in Amsterdam, Mayer coined the term tobacco mosaic disease after proving that the mottled browning of tobacco leaves, which is a significant sign of infection, could be transmitted to healthy plants. He discovered this by draining the sap of diseased leaves and injecting it into healthy plants. Up to 80% of those healthy plants then became infected. Tobacco mosaic disease doesn't cause plant death, but can cause stunting when it infects plants in the early stage of growth cycle, thereby harming yields. Although the discovery of the disease was a crucial first step on the way to discovering the world of viruses, Mayer mistakenly believed the disease must be bacterial. Almost a decade later, in 1887, microbiology student Dmitry Ivanovsky started studying tobacco mosaic disease. He first tried to do something similar to what Mayer had done. Ivanovsky took the infected leaf's diseased sap and filtered it through a Chamberlain filter candle, which is a pressurized tube with a filter designed to filter out bacteria. He then injected filtered sap into healthy tobacco leaves and waited to see what happened. And guess what? These plants became infected too. Ivanovsky decided to take a step further and expand on Mayer's experiments by crushing up diseased leaves and placing them in healthy plant soil. He discovered that these plants would also become infected, but that healthy plants simply growing next to diseased ones would not. Still, he thought the disease must be bacterial, so he designed an experiment to prove this. Ivanovsky tried to grow the disease in an agar dish. If the disease was, in fact, bacterial, he should see it grow. As you know, bacteria love to grow on agar. When this didn't happen, he concluded that the disease must either be a bizarre type of microbacteria or another living creature. Maybe an alien? This would be the time for me when I would set the lab on fire and ran for my life. But he did not. Ivanovsky had discovered that tobacco mosaic disease was not caused by traditional bacteria, fungi, or other known pathogens, but he still wasn't sure what caused it. In 1898, Beijerinck was the first to call virus the mysterious creature connected to the tobacco mosaic. If I were him, I would have called it mother. It would have perfectly described what viruses mean to living creatures anyway. Okay, breathe, João, and back to Beijerinck. He showed that the incitant was able to migrate in agar gel, therefore being an infectious soluble agent. Ivanovsky and Beijerinck brought unequal but decisive and complementary contributions to the discovery of viruses. Today we know this mysterious pathogen was indeed a virus. We've even taken cute pictures of them. Viruses differ from other pathogens in many ways. They are tiny, approximately 100 times smaller than bacteria, making them difficult to detect with microscopes. There has also long been a debate about whether we can consider viruses to be truly alive. Viruses are made up of proteins and genetic material, like strands of RNA or DNA, but can't survive without a host cell. In the absence of a host, the virus is essentially dormant, or basically useless. After the discovery of tobacco mosaic virus, more discoveries were made. Scientists discovered the foot and mouth disease virus in 1898, a disease that causes blisters to form in the mouth and feet of cows and leads to walking difficulties. It was only 3 years later, in 1901, that the first human-infecting virus was discovered. This virus was yellow fever, one of the most lethal and feared diseases in human history. As the name suggests, yellow fever causes high fevers and jaundice, or yellowing of the skin, and other symptoms like headache, muscle pain, vomiting, and in severe cases, liver failure, which can be fatal. The virus originated in Africa, but by the 1700s had reached Europe and parts of North and South America. At the end of the 19th century, when the United States invaded Cuba during its war with Spain, it was estimated that for every soldier who died in battle, 13 died with yellow fever. In 1900, Army physician Walter Reed was tasked with investigating the cause of yellow fever. Through experiments, he discovered that the virus wasn't transmitted from person to person, but rather through mosquitoes. He paid $100 to each volunteer who allowed themselves to be bitten by a mosquito, which at the time was a lot of money, but probably not enough to risk your life. This helped establish that a mosquito became infected with the virus after biting an infected patient. The mosquito doesn't become infectious for approximately 2 weeks, but when it does, it can remain contagious for up to 2 months. The mosquito itself doesn't become ill. Walter Reed also conducted another experiment, the one which proved yellow fever wasn't bacterial in nature and was instead the same mysterious pathogen behind the tobacco mosaic disease. Today, there are 219 virus species known to infect humans, but this number is growing every year. On average, 3 to 4 new human-infecting virus species are identified annually, and viruses make up over 2/3 of all human pathogens. So, it's been 100 years of us finding the first virus, and there are still so many yet to be discovered. Which is fascinating, yet scary. The old saying is wrong. Best things don't come in small packages at all. Thank you for sticking around until the end of the video. Like if you want to tell me that you want to see more of these in the channel, and subscribe so the next time I publish a video, you'll be the first to watch. I will see you on the next video.